Thank you very much for the invitation. It's an honor to be here to show our work to you tonight. So I'm Konstantinos Pantazis. The other half of Point Supreme Office is my partner, Marianna Rentzou. Martin said the story. We were founded in 2008. At the time, we were still in Rotterdam having other jobs, but then half a year later, we moved back to Athens because we were missing our country and our city very much, and we had ideas about it, so we really wanted to do projects for it. The other way. Yes. So we have prepared a selection of projects to show you tonight. We have organized it in a few chapters. The first chapter, which is probably the most important one, is this one, the introduction, where I'll try to show you a little bit of Athens, what Athens is, and especially what Athens is to us and how we see Athens, because that is something that really forms a lot of the thinking that goes into the work, the projects. This is a photograph from the plane, from the window, so you can already see Athens is a very peculiar city. It's very untypical for Europe. It's very dense and very continuous, and it only stops where it meets the mountains or the sea. If you look at the center, it's pretty much the same. So Acropolis is here, and you see that the whole city is urbanized, so there's not much void, apart from there's no parks and things like that. So the only thing that's not built is the hills that happen to be left in the fabric. But what is strange is that, at least until a few years ago, because things are changing pretty fast, perhaps, Athens was always being communicated and remembered, understood by this. So the Acropolis, the Parthenon. So a lot of people abroad that we met in our travels told us that they had no image of what Athens is like, which was very surprising to us because of the fact that Athens actually does have this very peculiar identity. So in postcards, Athens is always hidden. You always get this thing to the front, and then Athens is this amorphous background. If you actually do look at Athens, the city today, you see this. It's a very typical Athens fragment, what you see. So you can see that it's built out of the same module, the polykatikia, it's called, the apartment building, which follows certain urban rules. For example, there's a setting back here for the light to enter to the street. There's always the sun shades for the sun to be blocked in the verandas, which are so pleasant to be in. And so you see that the city is completely built like this. And then you get this kind of very specific profile, which is the direct result of the regulations. Once we came across this painter, Spiros Vasiliou, and this painting especially, which became to us the perfect representation of what we see that Athens is. So what you see is that there is this continuous urbanization, the polykatikias that we just were looking at, but in fact there's always also the presence of the mountains that form the horizon on three sides of the city, and then there's always the sky, the omnipresent sky with a very characteristic and strong Greek light, and there's always a kind of outdoor space that where you are and where your experience of the city is formed. Sometimes it's a balcony, sometimes it can be the rooftop. So this all together, this creates a kind of very specific experience of the city. Then if we zoom out and look at the map, we can easily notice Athens is at the center of the circle that Greece is, and it's really close and surrounded by the archipelago of islands of the Aegean Sea. So it's easy to start thinking that actually Athens also has a lot of things in common with these islands. So this is the center of Athens, but this is more or less Attica, the place where Athens happens. And you see that there's direct connections to the islands around with a boat that sometimes takes as little as half an hour to reach the nearby island. In other words, if you are in the center of Athens and you take the car and you hit the coast, it's a straight line, it takes you about 15 minutes perhaps, and this is what you see. And if you drive along the coast, you start encountering these kind of amazing places, which again are very is the same thing as being on an island. These are all beaches around Athens in the wider Attica peninsula. And even if we think of the Acropolis of Athens, that's there, that's it there. It's also very much related to the way that island cities have been formed always. For example, this is Lindos, a town in Rhodes, with its Acropolis on top, on the highest part, and then the city growing downwards. So it's also very much the same. And if you look at Athens, this is the Acropolis rock. Just below is the first houses of the modern city, which were in fact built by islanders. So people from the islands, specifically in this case from Anafi Island, were the first ones to come to Athens to build the new city, and they started building the same architecture that they had been building on the islands, which was very much integrated to the topography. So it's really practical. Practically done. And sometimes if you look at island architecture, you can even start seeing similarities and with the architecture of the city. We at Point Supreme we're very much inspired, not to say obsessed, with Greek islands especially. There's moments like this, very ordinary things you see when you go to an island. So for example, this is something we just saw two summers ago on Kimolos Island. It's just a chapel, a very insignificant chapel. And we're very much interested in this kind of space that happens sometimes in places in Greece. What's interesting about this space to us is the fact that it's obviously not done by an architect or a designer, a professional, let's say, of our field. It's done by probably the priest and maybe his wife. Using things that were available at the local shop. There's no rules design-wise. It's just a kind of spontaneous, honest, personal expression for the space. And in fact, what's even more fascinating, there's a lot of ingenuity in it. So for example, you see here there's a kind of wire, a mechanism that brings the candle down. So it's also very playful and very smart. In its own way, and it's very liberated. So, for example, you see there's no care for alignments. It's just the pictures that were available placed in whatever way made sense. Or if you look at this picture, for example, that we very much like, is a picture of a typical Christian ceremony right after Christmas. It's the christening of Christ. So the priest is going to throw the cross into the sea. What you see here is another experience that we think is very intense and very expressful. But actually the architecture is very simple, very insignificant. It just serves the scene. Of course, there's a lot of symbolism and a lot of color and expression, but the architecture is very simple. And some other examples, for example, this, actually it's also Kimolos Island, you see the very simple poor means where people, residents, claim spaces or delineate spaces, in this case just by using color, like painting different patterns to differentiate. Or another one, this is an antenna for a television that somebody combined. This is a stair, somebody made this door frame to go to the roof, and combined with these things, this is the pole for the flag, so it becomes a very complex object, very interesting object. So that was a little introduction about Greece, Athens and the islands. And I'm going to show you first compilation of little of projects that are very linked to what you saw, our reading of Athens. For example, this one is the first project we did when we went back to Greece in 2008. It was called the legitimization of the undervalued. It was about the polykatikia, this building type that you saw that makes up the whole city. Because when we were abroad, we started to appreciate very much this type that makes our city, but then we realized that most of the people have a very negative feeling about it. If you ask residents of Athens, they'll tell you they probably hate it. So we started a campaign about the polykatikia, trying to expose its potential and its capacity, because it's a typology that makes the city work very well. So we even proposed this Lego to make a toy out of it, which was not approved. We proposed a series of stamps showing the polykatikia instead of the typical stamps that show temples and sculptures, and we did a little exhibition about polykatikias that were becoming accommodating exceptions in order to solve urban problems. So if there's a problem of lack of space for sports or a swimming pool in Athens, we started to introduce it into polykatikias. Because in fact, polykatikias, it's the only building that's getting built. So we thought if we need anything, it has to take the to be disguised as a polykatikia or to be accommodated in it, which already happens in a way. So cinemas, supermarkets, everything is in polykatikias already. That was a very free, playful project. Years later, we kind of continued it with this one, which was a more serious one. It was a real tourist campaign with souvenirs for Athens that are actually now being sold. We did it together with a friend, a philosopher and poet. The name for the campaign was Only in Athens, so it was a campaign of souvenirs that were highlighting things that are very ordinary, but actually only are in Athens. So this was the logo for the tourist campaign. It was this metope, showing all the building types that make up the city, so the polykatikia, the Orthodox church, the kiosk, the umbrella on the beach, and the remains of temples, as opposed to this campaign. And then there was a lot of images that were printed on t-shirts and other things. So this was about the polykatikia, always framing your view of the city, your experience, because it's always there. This was about the relation of the polykatikia to ancient sculptures. This was also the opening slide. It's about the hidden open-air cinemas, one of the most magical places in the city. This real picture is about the stray dogs. Another real picture was about slogans written on temples at the time of the riots. And then there was maps showing Athens cut out of the mountains that connect it to the mainland, and so shown as part of the island archipelago, as an island itself. This was about the balconies, maybe the most critical space of any apartment in Greece, in Athens. And this was little marble sculptures of polykatikia being sold next to the typical sculptures of goddesses and gods in the tourist shops. There were a few other things, like these little mosaics of polykatikias and other t-shirts showing Likavitos mountain, the other mountain instead of the Acropolis. And this one, a side project, was called Athens as an Island. It made this portrait of the city, but shown as an island. So in fact, the urban fabric of the polykatikias was replaced with the fabric of the island houses, which is not so different in the end. This was a tablecloth of Athens as an island, because when you go to the islands, you always get served on a paper tablecloth that has a map of the island, so you can navigate and plan your holiday. So we made a kind of map for Athens as if it was also an island. And this was another project. Let me follow the time a bit. And this was another project which was focusing on the mountains of Athens. So it was an attempt to get our view away from Acropolis, since everybody was just looking at the Acropolis when they were talking about Athens. So we made this portrait called the Tribute to Madelon, where we started to show Acropolis together with Likavitos Hill. and implying that the two hills have a relation, a secret relationship, because Acropolis is a female word in Greek, and Lekavitos is a male name, a male word. This is an actual postcard of the two. So we did this project, which was called Athens by Hills, and it was a proposal to start looking at Athens and thinking of about Athens as a city not only of the Acropolis Hill, but of a network of hills. Because actually Athens does have a network of hills, it's just that the other ones are not branded, they're not really known, so nobody really knows what happens on them, apart from the areas that are surrounding them. So we did a study about what every hill is and what kind of programs and uses are there, and we started to propose to promote the uses that were already there and to exaggerate them. So this was a part of that campaign, that project, in this case, exaggerating the different typologies of hills, because that was the interesting thing about this project, of course, to look at the network and try to highlight what's original, what's different on every hill. For example, this hill, Turkovunia, in the center of Athens, has a lot of wildlife, so we turned it into a zoo. Or the Lekavitos Hill, the big one here, since Acropolis is this permanent, ancient, heavy monument we proposed, and very stable, we proposed on Lekavitos Hill to put a Ferris wheel to create the opposite, like a very mobile, light, playful icon on it, so to create this relationship. This project, like this series of projects, have been published a lot in the press in Athens, in the regular press, not architectural press, which is it's very important to us, because these projects actually do address the people, the people of Athens, not architects, not colleagues. So it's very important to see that they get picked up by the public and that the public is interested to see these thoughts. And another similar project, the last one, is this one. So it's again about the way we look at Athens and the way we represent it and talk about it. This project was inspired by this, the series of Japanese series of paintings called 100 Views to Fujiyama of Hiroshige and Hokusai. So in this series of paintings, one thinks that they're looking at the views of Fujiyama, but actually what happens is that one looks at what happened at the time in Japan around, of course, the mountain. So you get views of different activities at all times of the day and all seasons of the year, etc. So we use the same strategy, the same trick, and in fact invited some Greek photographers that happily also all of them accepted to participate in this project. So we asked them to start photographing Athens happening around the Acropolis, so that the Acropolis is always there, but then actually looking at the different things that happen around it. So this is by Philippidis, photographer, a picture of the hill just across the Parthenon. This is tourists on a rooftop. The Olympic Stadium here, tourist groups. This is sports happening just under the hill. This is a kind of typical roof view with the polykatikia density below. The metro going just past under the Agora, Kolonaki residential area, the Herodion ancient theater, etc. This project, I think, I will not describe to save some time. It was a marble mural. It was about marble and its diversity. It was about highlighting the richness of marble. I'll move into the next chapter called Rooms. It's about more specific spaces in Athens. So I showed you a little bit of some projects that have to do with how we think about Athens and how the city is communicated, perhaps. And I'm going to show you some more architectural projects now. starting with some public spaces. So this is a public space called Theater Square. So it's actually called the Square. It's in the center of Athens. You see here the Acropolis. And there was a competition about it to turn it into a square, finally. This was the situation, the existing situation. So we were very excited about this space always because it has this very strong character to it. It's really like an urban room and it's really close to Acropolis. It's really at the center of the city. So we knew that in the competition, every architect, I mean, that's what happens in Greece, would basically pave the whole place and add a few trees as decoration somewhere. And because nature is very much not treated with care, in Greece we wanted to do a this project to turn it into a kind of manifesto about nature. So to try to put nature not in a decorative way, but in a more essential way. And also we wanted to intensify, to have the relation to the Acropolis. So we had to think about something high, something vertical. So we decided to do a kind of building, but like a temple, but a temple made of trees. So basically to make architecture out of nature. So we had to use palm trees and cypress trees. This was the proposal. We planted the whole thing in a grid of tall trees and then low trees, of course, below as well. But also what was important is because these were kind of empty buildings, empty office buildings typical in the center of Athens, we also proposed to add balconies to all these buildings and turn them into residential. So it was a time where the center was really empty and this was a junky spot. So we wanted to create value and this was a good way to combine, to bring people in and also do the space. This was the ground experience of it. And another one, so there's a series of these kind of proposals for squares. Sometimes they're on our own initiative, like this one. The previous one fitted in a competition that was announced, so it's a kind of, there's different occasions. So this one is a project we did on our own initiative. It was about water. We wanted to do a project about water because we noticed that there's no water in the center of Athens, in the city center. So of course there's the coast, but then the center is completely devoid the element of water. So we noticed this square, which is on one of along one of the most central streets. This is Panepistimiu Street, University Street, and there's this square which has this small recess. So this center space goes down two steps. So we simply propose to fill in this space with water and turn it into a shallow pool, which would make a lot of sense, of course, for Athens, given the climate and the heat and all that. This project was so attractive to a certain group of civilians, Athens people, that they, on their own initiative, they took this project and they found a sponsor, a German company that does pools, and so they arranged that they would do this project for free for the city. So we went to the city, we were invited by the city hall to go and present it to them, so we did this model of it. And the project nearly got done, but in the end it was stopped because apparently this existing square is listed as a kind of monument or something. And then another one, another square, very close to the two previous ones, is this one. Actually, it's the City Hall Square. So this is the City Hall. So it's a very charged space. It's a very strange kind of shocking space to us. It's very typical Athens. So what's shocking about it is that there's no shade. So it's all hard paved. As you see, nature is really like in the periphery. So in fact, most of the time of the year, you cannot cross it because it's just too hot. It's really not fun. And there's the fountain in the center, which this is a photo, a very rare photograph where the fountain actually works. So usually it's completely dry. So we made this project to completely reverse that the existing situation, where what happened is we proposed to turn the whole surface, because it's such a big surface really at the center of the city as well, to turn it into a soft ground and just add sprinkles everywhere. So this is also kind of a typical piece of nature just around Athens, where the fields are. And another project, which is not a square, it's a street, it's this street. So this is the street that I mentioned earlier, that you take it from the center of Athens, which is here, and you take it and you go directly to the coast. This is where the islands start up there. So this is a very important street. But if you look at it nowadays, nothing tells you, nothing reminds you of the magic of this street that really points to the Aegean Sea. So, of course, there's all this crap that blocks your view. So you see the sea when you start the street, but then you kind of forget about it because, of course, you're busy driving. And there's no pavement in the middle, so there's no pedestrian space. So we propose to reverse that also, so to add the space here with a tramway and a wide pavement, so you can actually walk and take your time walking towards the coast, and also to kind of change the program that is along the two sides of the street to try to promote water-related programs or summer-related programs, because this street potentially could have a very strong identity. So this was about specific spaces in Athens. And now I'm going to show you a few projects that are a little bit bigger scale. Starting with this one. This one is called Athens Heaven. So we found out at some point that Athens has one of the smallest percentages of green per capita, per person. So in fact, there's a number regulated by the European Union that says that every European capital should have at minimum 7 square meters of green per person. So most cities in Europe, most capital cities in Europe have much more than that. That's the absolute minimum. So even Paris or London, that I wouldn't necessarily think of as a especially green city, they have something like 27 square meters per person, so much more. Well, Athens has 2.7, so one third of the absolute necessary amount. So we decided to try to see what that size is and what it means, and try to communicate it to the city. So we measured the amount of green that's missing from the city, and we drew it on the map, and it's this big. So this is it in relation to the biggest greens in Athens, basically the hills. This is the size of the hills in the city, and this is the missing green. So we noticed that it's exactly the size of a municipality in Athens, Kalithea. That's the one that links the center to the sea, because that's another kind of weakness of Athens nowadays. The relation to the sea is a little bit weakened. That's also related to the previous project. So we decided to place this missing green here, hence the weird shape. It's the shape of the municipality. And this was the image we did for the project. That was a little bit simpler, of course, for communication reasons. And so this image was proposing the cut to connect also the center to the sea. So this project also got a lot of attention from the press, and I think it did its job communicating this problem. And this is another project about public space. It was proposing to, because as you saw, there's no big empty space in the center of Athens. Like a park, we proposed to use the rooftops, which specifically taking a ferry boat and placing it on top of the rooftop. So this is Exarchia area, the student area. So this would, at the same time, it would make a beautiful public space in the shape of the deck of the public of the ferry boat. But what's most important is that it would materialize this metaphor, this relationship of this surface to the Aegean Sea that's right next to it. In this drawing, you can see some of the projects we were looking at before. So this is the square pool, and this is the theater square with the palm trees. and some others. So we're going to see this one soon, the pier. This is a deck. So this is now the pier, a project that pretty much brings together a lot of the ideas that you saw earlier. This was a competition that we were lucky enough to win some years ago. The story is that they were making a very... They're planning to redo a part of the waterfront here. It's where the Athens Haven big green thing touched the coast. And on top of this, there was going to be the Rentzou Piano New Opera and Library building, which was finished 2 years ago. It's this one. So as part of this big development of the park that was supposed to happen, there were going to be some piers, and they asked in the competition architects to make proposals for an icon to be placed at the end of one pier, of the central pier. So that was the brief of the competition. So at that point, we knew that what other architects would propose would be, of course, icon and sea. It would be kind of wavy shapes. This is the other prizes, I think, of the competition. So we wanted to do something that related to all these projects you saw before, of course. So something to facilitate the way that Athens actually works. So we proposed to use this end of the pier. It was given as a square shape by the competition. We proposed to turn it into a kind of station and to park a ferry boat in front of it. So this was going to be part of the project, the ferry boat. And so that these two things could work together. So there could be events happening in the water that you could watch from the tribune on the pier or from the ferry boat, or there could be events on the ferry boat, or there could be any kind of combination. But the most interesting thing is that then, at the same time, the pier would become a station for water taxis that do not exist now in Greece, so that these could take you to the rest of the coast. So this is the pier here. So the yellow lines are the water taxis that could take you anywhere. But also the white line is the ferry boat route. So the ferry boat could also do events that could take up to 2 hours, for example, doing this route, maybe touching Hydra Island there. So that the whole thing would change the way that the coast is experienced. Of course, the pier itself had to have a huge canopy on top in order to make it usable. So this is the structure for that, the ferry boat, the whole thing working together. And the other thing we did for the competition is that they were asking for a restaurant and cafe. So we proposed to elevate these on the first floor so as to allow the whole ground floor to be public, so free for everybody. So this was a series of plans we submitted with showing the different types of event and the relationship between the two elements. And this is a photograph of precedent, so a ferry boat that actually did this. So there was, some years ago, there was a performance, in fact with Chloé Sevigny from the States, who came to Athens and did a theater play that started on the ferry boat in Athens, but the ferry boat started moving, traveled to Hydra Island and came back. And it was a complete success. It was sold out and everybody that was on it said it was an amazing experience. So the whole project was based on that thing that had already been tested. So this is the images of the competition. And at some point in 2012, we were invited to show some of these projects in the Venice Biennale. So we did this series of models. It was called Made in Athens. So every project in this selection was presented in a kind of podium that showed one of the main images of the project, but together with a kind of action that happened in front of it that was kind of completing or highlighting a hidden element of the project. So you saw some of these, most of these, before. And at some point, there was also a book printed about Athens projects in Chicago. Okay, so now I'm going to move into some realized projects. starting with a canopy. So this was a competition that we won in Tel Aviv. The competition was asking for affordable and easily repeatable ideas for shade, because in especially in Tel Aviv they have a huge problem of lack of shade, because the whole city is Bauhaus, of course, and Bauhaus is made in Germany, right? So Tel Aviv has a Mediterranean climate, so it's not absolutely working. So we were invited to take part in this competition, and we decided to do a very simple project, which was based on this, on the typical Greek sunshades, which are very effective, very cheap, very easy to do. And so we did this. We proposed to do, this was the site given to us. We proposed this, this was the plan. We proposed to make a module of 10 meters by 5 meters, so a very long, simple rectangle that then would have this cut pieces of fabric rearranged to make a graphic effect. The point was to make these lines in the city so that these could become also kind of little new monuments or kind of icons, kind to give identity to the public spaces where they would be placed. So that, because otherwise it would be uncontrollable, because they wanted, in the competition, they wanted these ideas to be applied anywhere afterwards without you like checking. There was a few hidden details, like some playful legs. In the end, we constructed three modules, not six. So this was the result. And soon after that, we did a proposal that was on our own initiative about the playground. Martin mentioned it briefly. Because we noticed that actually playgrounds in Greece are very bad. They're just scattered toys like this on a site with no imagination and no variety. So in any playground you go, it's always the same thing. So we started to look for sponsors. We had some initial ideas and different ideas, and we started to look for sponsors because, of course, nobody asked us to do this project. And in the end, we ended up only getting one positive reply, which was from a company that actually sells these typical toys that are used everywhere. So this was the best ones of their catalog. So we had to do something with these. So this is one of them. So we decided to... And at the same time, we were trying to contact municipalities in Athens to see if somebody was interested in actually giving us a site to put it, and we got a positive answer from a suburb in Athens called Egaleo. They gave us this circular site in the middle of a square, which used to have a playground before. So we proposed this, to make a circle and put all the toys together, but kind of disguise them in a simple way. So that the point is that the kids would look at each other while they're playing, but also they would have the feeling that they're all sharing the same toy. So we made the permission for the building permission. This was the final form of it, following all the regulations. But in the end, the company that was giving us the sponsorship backed off because they kind of went bankrupt with a crisis. So now this is paused until further financing is found. Then I'm going to show you a project, this project, which is a residential one, an apartment. It's called Nadia Apartment. This project is interesting to us because it is very much close to the Athens projects that I showed you earlier. It's very much a project that materializes a lot of the ideas that I talked to you about before. It's a project, it's a house on two floors. So what happened is that we took all the private spaces, so all the bedrooms and this sort of thing upstairs, and we demolished the whole interior of the ground floor, of the lower floor. So there's no walls. So all the program happens as little islands. So in the empty lower floor. So there's islands of activity, and what basically had to be designed is the relationships between these things. So everything has its own identity and its own hidden references and agenda, let's say, its character. And what's And by themselves, maybe they're not so fascinating, but it's pretty fascinating what happens when they're brought together. So this is the ground floor we're talking about, and this is the upper floor. Also, what was interesting is that we found a lot of materials. We started to find a lot of materials for this project in junkyards, and which is the places where they throw away. Or they have things from houses that have been demolished, old houses, so that we could afford interesting tiles, nice materials, and doors and things like that. Because the clients were very interested in it, so it was a very good opportunity for us to do it. So this was one of the process drawings where we had kind of set up what goes where and how it works. And this is it, the interior. So we show it here together with Athens by Hills, because to us it's very much the same. It's something that we realized after we finished it, in fact. So this is the opposite view from the view you saw at the beginning. And at the center there's a very complex construction, this one, which has the stair, part of the living room, but part of the kitchen also on the other side. And this is a picture from the entrance where there's this Japanese-inspired screen. It's very much like a garden screen. And there's a lot of graphics on the floor that afterwards we realized they're, of course, inspired by ferry boat graphics. We had been working so much with ferry boats and all these things, Athens, that islands, things that we didn't realize that they came into the project until after we did it. Again, a ferry boat. So what happened is, because there's no walls to delineate the spaces, we use these kind of tricks in order to create a sense of threshold, of change between the different spaces. And one of the floors is also very much like outdoor spaces on islands, this pebble, handmade pebble floor. This is at the upper floor, the sun rising after the ground floor. Is that okay? Not too bad, I hope. Yeah, okay. I'll just go fast with this. Okay. And the second residential project I'll show you. It's okay with time, right? I think I'm not late. It's this and one more. So, okay, so this is the second residential project I'll show you tonight. It's called the Petralona House. It's actually our own house. It's a very interesting situation. So this is the Acropolis up there. This is the backside of the hill. This is an existing house that was being on sale. It was kind of a bargain, because as you see, the neighbors are really close. so we got this house and we decided to build on it. But we were also very much in love with it as it was. It's a typical Greek old house. Very complex. Very fascinating. So we decided to build above it like this, so as to allow the sun, which is coming from this direction, to still reach the garden in the back. And this was the project for it. So the ambition was to keep the ground floor a little bit like the existing ground floor, so to have a kind of ground floor house, but then with an extra bit on top. Charouhis, a painter, where you see a kind of house which has the same kind of effect, I think, where the house is more than just one house. So again, we're, like I told you, we're kind of fanatics with junkyards. So we were cataloging materials and things already from the past. So this was a great opportunity to start using them. So tiles in this case, but also marbles next to toilets, and this is the balcony that ended up being here on the street. Doors, amazing doors, very cheap doors, But in the end, basically, we didn't have to pay anything for it because we found them on the street, just outside our office. So we had these doors next to our meeting table for about 2 years because we had to have them around until the point we were going to use them. So I think this is the two bathroom, or this is the one bathroom door that you see here. No, this one. And this is the other one. Very, very nice pieces. What happened with this house is the following. Because we were at the same time as building it for ourselves, we were publishing the previous project, not the apartment. And the previous project got a lot of publicity. And a lot of times they were asking us about the materials that we used, like what company did you get the tiles and which shop did you get these. So we thought to use this as a strategy while we were at the point of having the concrete up in this project, then we decided to start contacting companies on our own initiative about this project and asking them to sponsor us with materials and things, because we told them we're probably going to get publicity so we can make sure to mention you all the time so you get publicity from it. And we got a positive response from all of them. So we got a lot of things for free, so the bathrooms and the electricity stuff and the kitchen and really a lot of things, the floors. But what happened with that is that the consequence was that, of course, we couldn't really choose exactly what we wanted, because the companies that would say, yes, we sponsor you, for example, the bathrooms company, we really didn't like what they had. So we had to adjust the project to whatever was available. For example, these blue tiles we found in the throne in a junkyard. So we would never probably choose exactly these ones, but they fitted and they were enough. So this was how this project was made. So that was very interesting. This is the side view with the concrete, exposed concrete, which is very typical in Greece. You see it here. From the back. So also about the project, we curved the roof here in order for the sun to also reach the back of the building, because otherwise this volume would block the sun from reaching the back. And this side looks to the Acropolis, so it's painted with some ancient Greek pottery figures of marathon or athletes. This is some photos of the interior. The house is very still unfinished at this phase where we last photographed it. This is, I think, a year ago. We showed it together with some examples of Greek traditional architecture in Chicago recently in the biennial. So this is again a chapel. We're looking at the central space of the house, which is empty. It's kind of then there's a tree planted in it, so there's a hole in the floor, so the earth comes in. So the garden kind of feels like it's coming into the house. So one side of this space is the library, and then another side is this, which we call the facade. So this is kind of the facade of the house. It's inside. It's still not finished here, but you see that it's kind of different houses on top of each other, a little bit like this example photographed by Aris Konstantinidis, an important Greek architect of the past century. And the other side, looking towards the garden. You see, what's interesting about the house actually is that there's no columns at all inside. So the house is basically hanging from above like a bridge. And these glass doors can be moved to the side, so this corner completely connects, opens up to the garden. This is the back side with the veranda. So this veranda is actually the roof of the previous house that was there. And soon after this project, we decided to do another one, which was a representation of the house. Because we were so surprised ourselves about the richness of the materials that we had put together in the house, some of them found in the streets or the junkyard, some others donated by companies, and some kind of made, handmade by us. So we decided to try to tell this story. So we made this. It's called the totems. It's lines of materials or items in a sequence that is also very much close to the experience you have in the house. So this more or less represents the things that you meet when you start the house, the when you come, and this is the middle, and this is kind of the last things you discover, mostly upstairs. So it's very interesting, this project, because if you pay attention, because it's very opposite things coming together in these lists and into the house, because there's things that are, for example, this one is a old tile from a neoclassical house found in a junkyard, very nice. This is a handmade marble piece by a sculptor from an island. It goes on top of the windows on the islands to allow the breeze to come in. This is handmade by us. It's part of the door, the entrance door. This is a donation of a plug. This is found again in junkyard. So there's kind of handmade, but also modular, like this tile, but sometimes, I don't know, valuable, sometimes not at all. It's a project that is very much close to our identity. So our name, which is Point Supreme, Le Point Supreme, means it's something that it's a term by André Breton from the Second Manifesto of Surrealism, where he wrote that the ambition of any surrealist act is to reach a point where all contradictions are resolved, so where all opposite things can be together without a problem, which is more or less what happens in dreams, where different things happen and it doesn't matter about the scale or, you know, what they were supposed to be. So this is a quality that we try to find in our work, to kind of ignore or get away from the standard or what is expected from a material or from a relationship, you know, where we have, especially in our training architects, we are, I think, typically taught to think that there's a right and a wrong way, and things, certain things go together and certain things don't. So we try to get over that. So I'm going to show you a last project. This one is called After Utopia. It's a pretty strange project. It's the last project we have realized. It was part of the Biennial of Design of Ljubljana, which is actually still running. It was this summer. So what happened is we were invited by the curators of it, who is Angela Rui and Maya Vardian. They made a very strange and experimental program for this biennial. So they wanted to get away from the typical biennial where people go and exhibit things in a place, and they wanted to curate a kind of biennial which would spread into the whole country. Slovenia, in this case, and that would interact with the country. So they made a program. They made a list of seven topics related to seven types of location in the country, and then they invited seven international architects or designers to each curate one of these seven topics. For example, there was a topic about the forest. There was a topic about the city, there was one about the water, the sea, one about the caves, because there's a lot of caves. In our case, we were given the place of the mines. Because there's a lot of mines, there's one town in Slovenian called Tribolje, it's a village, and it was made for miners. So miners, they built this town for miners to go there to work. This town has the second tallest chimney in Europe. It's 330 meters, and it has a network of hidden mines below, tunnels of about 70 kilometers So it's a crazy place. So they gave us this topic and they, this place, together with the title After Utopia, because this place is not a mining town anymore. The mines are closing, so nobody knows what will happen to the town. So we started going there often, thinking that we would do a project about the mines, which sounded very fascinating. When we went there, we were pretty surprised with what we saw, because this looked like a very ordinary, normal, and pretty boring place, Tribolia. But then we started to see pretty weird things. For example, the town is full of this kind of crazy machines. You don't imagine the scale, but a person is probably, I don't know, super small here. And this, they had this amazing infrastructure, industrial things happening. We found a map of the mines, so the town is this line, it's just a little line with houses around, and this is the situation of the mines. And we went there underground a lot of times, thinking about doing a project about it. This is the entrance of the town with a huge factory, a Lafarge. At first, we started to be, at the same time as working about, thinking about the mines, we started to be troubled about the city itself and how it was understood by the people there, because they had all these crazy things happening around them, but the people didn't seem to acknowledge it. So, for example, we started meeting people like women that did sewing, like this thing, and they were, the designs they were doing were butterflies and flowers, like you do anywhere else in the world. So at the same time, we started to do, it's a little bit like the Athens projects you saw, I think, in the beginning. We started to try to visualize a little bit the identity of the town, how we understood it or how we would propose it to be. We made this tablecloth where we used only metallic colors, the colors, the actual colors of the place, so a lot of grays and desaturated colors, and trying to accommodate a little bit of the flowers that they were used to, but proposed to them to start putting their actual place in their souvenirs, for example. But then the final hit for us was when we entered the house in this town. So this is a house, a typical house, and we went there to meet somebody that we were told was interesting, and we entered the door and we saw an airplane. And so we found out that this guy was building airplanes on his own, but seriously doing it. So he had sold about 300 airplanes to the Russian army. And nobody knew about it. So I think if you asked two houses below his, nobody probably knew that he was doing it. So we started to realize that there was a kind of hidden world in this town that looked so ordinary in the beginning. So we started to forget about the mines and started looking at the people and started to try to meet as many people as we could. So it was shocking, the types of people we met. We tried to make like be strict about it and make a selection of, and in the end it was 16 stories, we called them. All incredible stories. You probably know Laibach, a band who's given a concert in Stockholm, 11 November. I just saw the poster outside. So this is a world famous band coming from this town, super industrial, heavy music. It's the first band that gave a concert in North Korea. So this is Hiroshi, and a scientist that goes from Osaka to Tribolia, this village, all the time, together with his clone, who's a robot that completely interacts with you. And he goes to Tribolia. He's obsessed with it. There's young companies. Let's see. Well, they're not here. There's a group of young people that have a software company that sell their software to NASA. And there's another group of teenagers that this summer they were planning to send a rocket to outer space, and they probably managed. So they designed the rocket on their own, so as to put Slovenia in the list of countries that have activity in outer space. Then there's a lot of extreme sports. This is pretty typical of Slovenia in general, but in Tribolia it's out of control. So there's people that climb this chimney at 330 meters in the sky and do this kind of things without protection. It's really crazy. But there's also all kinds of people. There's this group of women, elderly women, that decided to make a puppet theater group, and they're touring the whole continent, Europe. They're touring, and they write the text, and they do the costumes and the puppets and everything. There's this choreographer, famous worldwide, Isto Kovac. Actually, he was our collaborator in the project, amazing person, and a lot of other stories. A very interesting story. So we decided to do the project about these guys because we thought this is the answer to after utopia. This is what happens after planning. This is what happens after the dream is changed. It's all about the imagination and the obsession and the initiative that normal people have. So it was about people getting out of the limits of their life and doing things extraordinary. So we started to try to abstract all the characters into the essence of their identities. And we had to do, the project had to be twofold. We had to do a project that would be exhibited in Ljubljana, in the capital, in the Museum of Design. And we had to do also an intervention in the town. So it was a lot of work. For the museum, we decided to make a space which would be a circle, like the mines. It's all about circles in Triboli, also the chimney. So this circle would be we called it the curtain of extraordinary beings. So it was going to highlight all these stories, but also put them together for once, because nobody knows each other doing all these things there. So this was the curtain with all these symbols for every story, it being set up. And then at the end of the exhibition, we made a... One of our collaborators made a movie about all this with all the characters talking, and here they're all connected together in the exhibition, because we realized, of course, and that was the interesting thing of the project, that they all had common obsessions, in fact. It all had to do with space and the lack of limits, and also a physicality, the thing of being a human as opposed to being a machine, because they were all their life, they have been exposed to these gigantic machines. This is two of the puppets of the women, of the ladies. And then in the town itself, we decided to do this. It was the smallest possible museum. It was called the Tiny Museum, so it was a museum dedicated to the people there that was placed in the middle of the most busy pavement. So this was it realized. So there's every 2 weeks, there's a different exhibition there of the locals. Everybody is free to take the space and exhibit their obsessions or their collections or what they're making or what they're interested in. And there's this billboard here that informs you about it. So it works. I think people are pretty much curious about what's going on in it. This was the opening day with these ladies doing the puppet theater. We invited all the schools to watch. And then what was maybe the most fascinating part of the whole project is that we asked all the kindergartens and primary schools of the town to draw by memory this machine that was our favorite. And so we got their view and their take into their environment. So they made some amazing drawings where they... rethought about what the machine, how the machine works. it was very, very interesting. And then, of course, these were exhibited in the Tiny Museum. So this was a kind of closing of all our thinking, but then reintroduced into the people themselves, and having them think about their city and expressing their thoughts about it. And that was it. Thank you.